Welcome back, everybody, to Game 2 of Scythe versus Arrow Gaming after what was, to put it lightly, a rough game for Arrow. We're going to be kicking into Game 2 here. You know what that was? You know what that really was? It was basically Arrow Gaming were the cattle, and Scythe, Miracle especially, like that Timebreaker, he was like the, what's the device that they used to take out cattle? That's what it was, man. They were just lining up, and Miracle just taking them out one by one. It was just unbelievable. Odd draft is really what it came down to. And it's personally my fault for not calling it out from the very beginning. Why in the world did they pick up a lifesteal? I was just more into like, oh, look, we're going to see a lifestealer offlane. How interesting. You know? And then I was focused on, are we seeing tri lanes? Are we seeing dual lanes? But when it comes down to it, if you just look at it, it's like, why would you pick up a lifestealer versus a void in the first place? That they lead the faceless void by himself, and he will outlane the lifestealer, who is supposed to be a strong laner, but it comes down to it's just straight physical, raw physical damage versus a hero with very low armor. Of course, that's never going to go your way. And then on top of that, they had Ember Spirit versus a faceless void as well, which it wasn't necessarily their fault, but still, it was just pure and simple outdraft. So hopefully Arrow can do better this time around. You already see some big silver linings here. So first couple of bans, well, go through all the bans real quick. Brewmaster Doom, Razor, and Viper being banned away. I love seeing the combination of both Razor and Viper banned away by Scythe. Thank you. You guys are now my favorite team in the world. Naga Siren and Faces Void banned out by Arrow in the first set. Ember Spirit and Templar Assassin taken out in the second set. Now the silver lining here for DDZ.
10 seconds remaining.
Specifically. They may be one game down, but by God, they got a DDZ Invoker, and that is GG straight there. He is one of the best Invokers in the world.
Reserve time.
Without a doubt, the best Invoker in the Southeast Asian scene, in my mind. Shadow Demon being a good combination here with him already. So disruptions into a Soul Catcher. The Sunstrike over the top doing an amazing amount of pure damage that is amplified by the Soul Catcher. What's not to love so far about Arrow Gaming? Still, though, we're going to see the Skywrath Mage Centaur. Good, aggressive dual lane, potentially. Again, we talked about last game where the Skywrath Mage, I think he is one of the strongest offlane supports in the game, and you combine that with something like a Centaur, that it is an amazing amount of magic damage they can lay down in short period of time. So BKBs are going to be a must for Arrow going into the mid game. Grab themselves the Marauders, the third pick, but Arrow Gaming decide they're going to go with the Inhibba. So not only do we have now the Shadow Demon setting up the Invoker for Sunstrikes early on into the game, but later on into the game, we have the Enigma Black Hole, which if he catches out a couple of heroes, there is all kinds of havoc an Invoker can wreck with that. Lay down a Meteor, depending on his build, right? If it's an X-Sword build, then you go for the Meteor, Sunstrike, wait for the Black Hole to wear out before you throw out a Deafening Blast. If you go for the Quasuex build, EMP into a Tornado after the Black Hole is done. You know, there's plenty of things that an Invoker can play around with when it's dealing with an Enigma. Nice, though. Scythe. This, if you want a better offlane support, you can't get much better than Lich. Like, it is Skywrath Mage is strong. Lich is even better, though, just because of the natural way he pulls back the lane. So, looks like this is going to be a Lich-Centaur combination is where I would lead this to. Skywrath Mage as a support for the Marauna, possibly. They could run Marauna as a mid, but for now, we're going to call her as a one-position Marauna. And now they just need their mid to be left. Now, what's really strong about the Lich is not only gives them very strong dual lanes, but it also gives them an advantage for the over the Enigma, because we now have a long-range ultimate that is able to go through BKB and do a little bit of mini-stun. So if Enigma is able to catch out a couple of heroes with the BKB activated, Lich can still be the saving grace for his team where they had none before them. Like, if Enigma, I'm looking at that team, Skywrath Mage, Centaur, Marauna, I'm like, BKB is my first, maybe second item. Like, go for a mech, then the BKB, right? But now with the Lich, you're still probably going to go for the BKB and just try and catch out the Lich every single time in your Black Hole. But if you don't grab him, chances are your Black Hole is going to be cut short. Death Prophet now being grabbed by Arrow Gaming as well, so this is going to be a one position invoker, which gives more credence to the Lich offlane. Remember, you want to deny as much experience away from the invoker as possible, so Lich and the way he operates with his sacrifice is going to be even stronger as an offlane support. Death Prophet in the mid, and now we just need our offlaner, because we expect Enigma to be in the jungle. Scythe, they got to think about bans here and what they're going to pick up as their fifth. They've got a fairly aggressive, like, they've got good initiation between the Skywrath Mage as well as the Centaur, even the Mirana ultimate or the occasional arrow. All very good ways to be able to initiate. They for sure as hell have enough firepower in the mid game. There is not an issue with that whatsoever. So what are they truly missing? Well, they can pick up a mid carry for
Arrow
Miracle.
Gaming's turn to ban.
If they want to run this like really four-man aggressive lineup with a one-position mid that sits back and farms, they could go all in on aggression, but then I would want to see a pusher.
10 seconds.
Because
remaining.
They have enough initiation in the world. If they can get a strong early pushing
Five
hero, hell, like
remaining.
Even just go straight up the Pugna. Run Pugna in the mid, put your Mirana as a one position. If the game goes late, you're probably screwed, but it shouldn't go late. Should not go past 35 minutes. Not with a Pugna. Not with this kind of initiation offered to you. A Pugna will be able to allow you to take towers early, feed a lot of quick Blink Dagger gold into the Centaur. Faster he gets his Blink Dagger, the faster he can start rampaging around. And Arrow Gaming actually banning away the Klinks here. Not really a hero I was thinking of, but he is a decently aggressive hero, and he also is a strong pusher on top of that. We're going to see the Bristleback banned away. Again, taking away that offlaner when there's any signs of push, ban away the offlane Bristleback. I am in huge support of this. I think Bristleback has been heavily underutilized in the meta right now in these push lineups. Because what Bristleback gives you is not only a frontline hero, but also a strong physical damage dealer. If you're able to stack up some of those quills, you're able to do 200 damage a hit at level 8. It's ridiculous.
Reserve time.
So that just because of the nature of the hero, you can push down here the towers exceptionally quick, as long as you have the backup form.
10 seconds remaining.
So I'm very much in favor of that ban. It's also a potential hero who could get the mech if Death Prophet wants to go straight for Yule Scepter. There's also the Enigma who can go for the mech. So if Death Prophet has plenty of options here, if she wants to go for that fast Yules because she's going to be dealing with a Centaur and a Skywrath Mage initiating on her, I'm all for it. Go straight for the Yule Scepter and let the Enigma go ahead and grab the mech. It's going to be slightly delayed, but not by much since Enigma is one of the fastest junglers in the game. And we wanted to see a pushing hero for Scythe.
10 seconds remaining.
That's going to be the Lycan. So Lycan can be ran as
Five
a mid here.
Remaining.
Up against a Death Prophet, though, I'm not so shiny on that one. Lycan probably going to be the one with Mirana taking over that two position. There was a distinct possibility that Lich could also be run as a mid support. Again, one of the best in that position as well. But I'm presuming the Death Prophet's going to be middle and the Invoker in the safe lane. And I want to be able to match up the Lich against the Invoker if I'm Arrow Gaming. Clockwork going to be the last pickup here. They need an offlaner. They couldn't have the Bristleback. So instead, they get a decently tanky hero who's going to be able to provide them a lot of initiation. But what's really strong about the Clockwork here is he is an amazing frontline hero that is going to be able to give you space for the Death Prophet as well as the Invoker to be able to work around. If you can get a good set of cogs, initiate in, lock somebody inside the cogs, push the rest of the heroes behind that away, Death Prophet can come in with the ghost, clean up the one hero in the cogs, and then just move on from there. It's just going to be a quick, steady steamroll. Still, though, looking at the lineup, not too happy about the Lycan last pick here for Scythe. Wasn't quite
battle.
The hero I was truly expecting. At the same time, I do like the rest of their four. I think they've got a good chance of being able to win the laning phase once again. Arrow Gaming have such strong team fight, though. I mean, look at that. Between the Death Prophet, Enigma, Invoker, Clockwork, all exceptional team fighting heroes. So I'm actually going to be siding with Arrow Gaming for now. Their one big downside is going to be the fact that they have such long cooldowns on their ultimates. They can never have a team fight without Exorcism. They probably shouldn't have a team fight without Black Hole as well. And good lord, the pings! Ah! Pelosin, please calm down, sir. You're gonna make me go insane with your pinging. Good lord. Someone else ping too. Just everybody ping. Yay! They heard me. All right, so they're pinging out the wards that are currently being laid down. They expected a ward. You notice that Scythe actually faked out a ward here in this hard camp. That has not been blocked out.
The battle
there
begins.
Is one in the medium camp, though. That counter ward does block it up, as well as this observant ward does take out this camp. The box of the camp goes something like this. It's a very crude box, but it does catch out into this lip right here. So that ward's going to block it, as well as another counter ward blocking out this camp. So Scythe Gaming doing what they could to be able to stomp out the Enigma, and because of that, Enigma is just going to be focused on this one hard camp, is really what it comes down to. He's already got himself a couple of counters, so we'll see what he does with that. Which one he attempts to counter is probably going to go for this camp, I would say, as well as the ward right here. That would be the ideal scenario with those two counter wards. So our laning is going to be, we got X Freedom as the Skywrath Mage is going to be babysitting Miracle's Lycan in the top lane. We're going to have a mid Mirana, sure enough. And we're going to have a dual offlane between the Lich as well as the Centaur. And again, favorable matchup for them because they're denying a lot of experience away from the Invoker, like the lanes of Scythe, quite a bit. Especially with the way they countered this Enigma. If they can even just delay the Enigma for 1 or 2 minutes, it can pay off big dividends because at a certain point in time, the Centaur and the Lich can make a rotation and maybe get a gank on a low-level Enigma. Nicely done. Counter ward being placed down. First one by MTR does successfully unblock a camp as well as take away that rune vision that was offered by the ward. Chibi. Playing pretty aggressive here in this mid-matchup, trying to lay down as much harassment onto the Death Prophet as possible. And this makes a lot of sense for Chibi because he notices that Death Prophet went for a pretty greedy bottle build, went for the Null Talisman first into some branches, and still wants to be able to pick up a fast bottle. So Chibi's trying to take advantage of the lack of regen and the late bottle and try and harass him out of lane. Unfortunately for Mirana. Looks like he just used an arrow in order to clean up a creep. Unfortunately for Mirana, Lance is able to find a regen rune, and his whole entire plan of using this extra regen he had to bully Lance out of lane has been completely spoiled. Like, he was already taking enough damage by itself, but the regen just ruins everything. So, Lance should be able to win the mid lane. That's going to be fairly easy. Zhang Zai will have a very good time as a Clockworthen's top lane. He's dealing with a Skywrath Mage, but Skywrath Mage is very glass cannon-y, which is a word I'm making up right now. So Zhang Zai, with his extra level and battery salt, I like this build quite a bit because it threatens these heroes. It threatens the Skywrath Mage a lot. Lycan not as threatened before obvious reasons. He's going to summon extra units whenever he's put inside the cogs, so not that big of a threat for him, but all in all, Clockwork shouldn't really die in this lane. Mosin actually finding the other counter ward. Well done by him. Unfortunately, when he farms up, when the Enigma farms up this hard camp, the advantage of being able to take out this camp right here is that Enigma will lose his Eidolons by the time he gets to the next camp. Because they just simply do not travel fast enough. So it's still going to be able to slow down the Enigma's farm quite heavily. Miracle, though, he's farming quite well. Look at him, 24 and 5. Every single time Miracle is in a game, man, he is always topping out the board in CS. He simply does not miss. Lance is going to be caught out by the slow, and Chibi has a chance to be able to follow up with the arrow. It's just going to be a 0.1 second stun, but it should be enough damage for them to finish him off. Oh, he gets off the bottle as well as the disruption, and Lance is going to come back with a chunk of health that will allow him to survive, and Chibi now going in deep for the last hit. He gets it! A one-for-one trade, but the Clockwork Rocket and a Sunstrike over the top ensured Mirana's demise no matter what. So, one-for-one. on that attempt. So nicely done. Well played by the Shatter Demon coming in at the right time, plus the bottle hit. Lance was able to get off the bottle charge at the same time as the disruption was going out, so the bottle was healing him while he was out of combat. So they get a 2-for-1, sorry, is what I meant to say. Extremely in the favor of Arrow. And Death Prophet, now going to be able to pick up level 6 in a short amount of time. Now, level 6 is not the be-all, end-all. Oftentimes, you'll actually see Death Prophets go for Witchcraft at level 6 as well as level 7, because there is little point of leveling up Crypt Swarm an extra level
middle tower
early
is
on,
under attack.
Due to the fact that the last upgrade only gives you 50 damage and costs you an extra 25 mana. So it's really not the most effective level, whereas Witchcraft will give you a lot more at 6 and 7. And you need to be able to have maxed out Witchcraft in order to utilize your first Exorcism. Exorcism, an exceptionally weak ability at level 1, especially if you don't have maxed out Witchcraft. In fact, I would normally say Death Prophets don't go for their first push until level 11. Oftentimes, they simply fail, even at like level 9. If they try and go for it, oftentimes they will still fail. Miracle doing a great job utilizing the jungle and his early pickup, Ring of Basilis, as well as a Medallion of Courage. Expect Roshan to be on his hit list in the next 5 to 10 minutes. I would say closer to 5, though. With an early Medallion like that, you're showcasing that your Lycan wants to do Roshan as soon as possible. And it makes sense. They're on the Dire side. Take advantage. Haystrum going to be found. Runs Dire's into Lance, tower. But there's no one else attack. To take advantage of any potential slow by him. The Duskvin stand-in, Matero, is going to be joining the Dire's two other heroes of Arrow attack. For a bottom push. Still only level 4 middle lane. Looks like we're going to be able to catch out the Death Prophet as a 3-man rotation comes in. Chibi is joined by both Pelosin as well as the Skywrath Mage. So the Centaur makes his first rotation over. Now this does leave Radiant's the bottom lane very much exposed, but they're being slowed down by this Lich Armor quite heavily. Even just one point of Lich Armor can make killed. A big difference, and that was
Dire's structures are fortified.
Odd, to say the least.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Flying the Courier into Tier 1 towers, new strategy. Well done by Scythe. Can't say I've ever seen
Dire's
that
Dire's bottom tower has fallen.
Arrow, though, they do take their first tower. Chibi is going to get caught out here. Zhang Zai is going to catch him with a hook. Yep. Chibi, nowhere for him to run after that leap.
Is under attack.
So not only do Scythe die past the tower for unknown reasons, I realize they want to lay down as
Radiant's
much damage on the tower as possible, and that's
attack.
Why they went for that
Dire's bottom tower is under
extensive
attack.
Push. But they fed away the courier as well as a mid lane hero. Clearly not worth it. Miracle, in the meantime, is going to be able to take a tier 1 tower of his own, but it looks like the rotation of Arrow was able to find the Centaur Wartree, who is coming over to protect his tier 2 tower that Arrow is about to take. So successful rotation for sure by the Enigma.
Middle tower has fallen.
As Scythe just kind of failing to mount a response there. They easily could have been able to defend their tier 2 tower if Mirana had not been caught in the middle lane. Would have been a great opportunity for them to use their first Moonlight Shadow together. In the meantime, Pelosin's going to be trying to farm up his level 7 so he can have that maxed out double edge plus a Blink Dagger. And if he can catch it out before Lance has a Yule Scepter, there's very little a Death Prophet can do. You can't really get off the silence in time before you're stunned. It's the Yule Scepter. It's the instant double tap of a Yule Scepter that is going to protect you from the Centaur stun. He's going to need that for the Skywrath Mage as well. Protect him from that ultimate, so Yule Scepter is going to be a must here. Death Prophet still going to be going for the natural stat items first. It's not a big surprise there. When you say Yule Scepter first, you're talking about after your upgrade boots, maybe a couple stat items here. He may even go a full set of drums before he tries to go Yule. Zhang Zai is having a great time. Look at him. Level 8 plus a 4 staff. This is the exact opposite of that Lifestealer game. So it goes to show, it wasn't the player, it was just the hero that they picked for him, man. Just was not designed to win his lane. Here, Clockwork was designed to win his lane, and JagsEye's capitalizing off that beautifully. Having a 4-stab before the 10-minute mark is insanely fast.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Chibi trying to get as much physical damage of his own with a Phase Boots Wraithband build. And he's been making sure every single time he gets a chance, he lays down a couple of pot shots on the tower. DDZ, though, may be caught out here. The Centaur ultimate going to go off. Great cold snap, but he's still going to be caught by the arrow and brought down. Oh, but oh, beautiful! Matero comes in with a beautiful 3-man black hole, and that's going to hold him in long enough for JagsEye. He's going to get Pelosin. Chibi as well going to be slowed out by the purge, and a 3-man kill there, all because Matero comes in at the perfect time. Shift queues up a beautiful black hole. That leads to a 1-for-3 exchange. They may have lost the legendary DDZ Invoker, but well worth it for Arrow Gaming. Lance utilizing his first ultimate of the game. Exorcism gonna be trying to use on Roshan here, who's already brought down to about half health. There's no way a level 1 Exorcism like this can take down Roshan at full health. But at half health, it may be possible, especially with the addition of some allies. JagsEye going to be trying to play interference here, but blown up before he can even get off a set of cogs, and this is going to turn sour real quickly. MTR trying to slow him down. Oh, but here comes the Lich Ultimate already. Lance has been able to pick up. No, actually, DDZ grabs the Aegis. Chain Frost bouncing around is going to be able to clean out both of those heroes inside of the pit as the Shadow Demon is going to come back to some right clicks. MTR going to be taking out DDZ on the run. And if he loses the Aegis here as well, throws out a Sunstrike. Oh, he got him with the Lich. He goes down inside the pit. DDZ making the most of his first life, but he's not going to be making it out of the second one. His freedom slows him down. He tried to make it to the creeps in order to get a deny from the neutrals, but that's just not the case. And one great play from Matero for Arrow turns into a very overconfident misplay there from Arrow as they go into the Roche pit and actually get team wiped 11 and a half minutes into this game. Gotta say, though, I just want to take a moment. I know the Centaur Lich was a tough lane for the Invoker to be able to deal with, but was it tough enough that DDZ is only at 27 last hits? Not trying to flame the guy because he is an amazing, amazing Invoker, but I cannot believe that he couldn't have gotten more CS than just the 27
Dire's
he
top
had
tower is
by
under
12
attack.
Minutes. Arrow going to be going for another push. They need to start utilizing this exorcism to get some tower gold after that big throw by them in the Roshan pit.
Radiant's bottom tower is
rotation coming in, but this is a 4v3 fight. They may have the smoke advantage here. Oh, and a double damage. Radiant's or not double damage. Blink dagger already being picked up by Pelosin. If he can grab two with a stomp, they can easily win a 4v3. Even better now that Exorcism is down, and now he goes. Trying to go for MTR first. Laying down that damage. X-Freedom doesn't get off his ultimate in time, and they're actually able to get out of this one. Popping the mech in hand as well as the drums, trying to get out, turn around onto Kopi as well. Getting two quick kills.
Radiant's bottom tower
as it
attack.
Seems like whoever whoever is leading the game at one point in time just throws a little bit. Oh, beautiful. JagsEye with a good 4-stab is going to be able to catch out Miracle inside of the cogs. He's taking a lot of this physical damage, but if he can ensure and kill into the Lycan, but it's just not possible. DDZ didn't have anything left. He had no invoke. He invoked both Cold Snap and the Sunstrike. And didn't even put a dent in Miracle's health. Once again, we're going to see Scythe trying to initiate on this bottom lane. Good counter ward is going to be able to reveal the attempt of a Moonlight Shadow Gank for Pelosin. And he's forced to blink himself back away. DDZ is going to run into a Miracle here. Unlikely he's going to be able to take this kill. I mean, this is a Lycan, when he's sitting at full health, has 1300 plus another 17 armor. And a lot of your damage as an Invoker comes from your right clicks when you go for this Exort build. So the armor does make a difference. Oh, Arrow catching out Lance.
Oh, sweet.
Beautiful play there from Chibi. Gets them a free pickoff. And ensures a haste rune for himself as well. Four staff going to be grabbed by DDZ. Necessary for sure. Against the Centaur Blink, against the Skywrath Mage, slow silence ultimate combo. And even the Lycan, even though he's hasted up, just a small bit of difference can make a small bit of distance can make a big difference for him. A surprise to no one, Miracle topping out the net worth board at 8,500 gold already. Not as good as the last game, but given time. Just a casual 560 gold per minute. Yeah, couldn't quite hit the 700 by 15 minutes. But if this game continues on its trajectory, I'm sure he'll make it. Especially with the way he's about to start taking towers. He's going to be going for a combat build, by the way. You notice? This is a BKB build. He kind of already tipped it off with the medallion, but you could, there are builds that allow you to go for the medallion, do a quick Roshan, and still fall back on a Necronomicon. Pelosin with the big miss there in the top lane. It's going to be caught out. Actually, Chibi gets hit by the hookshot, but the center ultimate goes off. Pelosin trying to teleport himself away. Black hole, is it going to be used? Matero doesn't go for it. And Chibi does successfully dodge the Sunstrike there. That would have been a kill on the Centaur, and I think it would have been worth it for Matero. I mean, I know he's all amped up on that three-man black hole he got so early in the bottom lane, but sometimes it's worth it to just use a black hole on one hero. Especially considering the exorcism was utilized. They got nothing out of that team fight.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's structures are fortified.
Once again, Chibi trying to lay down what little damage he can on towers. Bit by bit, that middle tier one tower will fall. But at the same time, we do have the top tier two, which is going to be going down in a short amount of time. DDZ barely able to dodge a pretty clutch arrow there. Now he's going to be turned around on by Miracle. But DDZ's close enough to the tier two. Lance, meanwhile, going to be taking a lot of that magic damage. Hex Freedom, not enough to be able to finish him off. Not even the last nuke will do it. As Pelosin pansied out rather heavily there. Despite his high, high HP pool. Zhang Zai should have no issues dealing with this Murana. Leap over, double cogs going out. But he still has the four staff to be able to dodge the arrow. As long as he doesn't get hit by this, he's home free. Taking a look at the gold graph. Arrow Gaming are leading, but not by much. Scythe, very much ahead in experience, actually. So it looks like Scythe are winning this game. Still. The small amount of gold lead that was Jesus Pelosin. All of a sudden I see him drop down to nothing, and that's because he's just casually double-edging creeps. You know, leave yourself exposed to a Sunstrike. Look at him, he's like dancing around. He's so afraid of Sunstrikes at this point in time. DDZ doesn't even have it invoked though. Yule Scepter, quick Yule Scepter for the Death Prophet. Wonder if he's going to consider going for a BKB at this point in time, or if he still maybe goes for a Bloodstone. Bloodstone's a great tanking item for a Death Prophet, but I feel like a flat Vitality booster into a BKB would be a better build for Lance here in this game. Dealing with a lot of magic damage, and you probably want to try and end this game. Or at least get yourself a significant advantage before the Lycan becomes too risky, too big to deal with. And that's going to be about right now. Miracle is going to get his BKB, and there should be nothing stopping from Scythe forcing fights over and over again. Oh, Hook just caught out Chibi, who has already used his leap, and with the Sunstrike over the top, Chibi cannot be using that leap like that. He just used it to hop over the trees in order to get into the faster way into the river. But ends up getting caught out by the clockwork because of it. And with the BKB up on the Lycan, the only thing that is going to be able to stop him is cogs, hookshot, black hole. Well, okay, no purge. Purge can't stop him. I was going to start with the only thing that can stop him is black hole. And then it was like, well, cogs can, you know, keep you away from the target you're intending to go on. There's a hookshot stun. Fortunately, your purge, you're still hasted, so it's fine. He doesn't care about that. Ooh, two-man stomp there from Pelosin. Gets off the double edge. Mosin is going to be able to survive now with the mech going off. Pelosin completely overextending himself. And it's going to be just right-click down as the rest of the Scythe are going to be backing up. Like an ult being popped, but he's going to be going straight into a black hole if he attempts to force this fight. This is not what he wants to see. Another big misstep here from Scythe. Very, very, what's the word I'm looking for here? It's just not clean. The gameplay is not clean here from either side. We have throws back and forth. I mean, it's one hell of an entertaining game, but I think it's not unfair to say whatsoever that both teams are looking quite rusty. You can't afford to be making those kind of mistakes up against or having a push squad like this. Chibi has been found. He does have a leap, though. Zhang Zai gets in front. Silence goes out. This may be enough to be able to get the kill. Chibi gets the leap away at the last second. The attempt at pursuit by the Clockwork is not going to be able to catch up in time. And Chibi actually bought his team a good amount of time because he had a regen on top of it. So he can just teleport back to base. He bought his team maybe an extra minute of farming. Not bad at all. But the only reason he survived there was because the silence was only level 1. Looks like Bloodstone is going to be the answer for the Death Prophet. But for now, they're going to start laying down some damage onto the tower. That Lich Armor is doing a good amount, though. The extra 7 armor. Mitigating a lot of this straight physical damage from the Death Prophet. Now the Centaur is going to initiate, but he's going to go for Mosin in the back. Mosin gets force-staffed in and saves himself with a good disruption. Now a beautiful set of cogs is going to push away those two melee heroes. Miracle trying to go for the Death Prophet to take away that damage dealer, but it's just not going to be found. MTR is forced to turn around to get off the black hole onto Miracle, but he's going to be stopped, and now Pelosin comes in. Hits another stun. Bouncing from the Lich Frost is not going to be doing enough. Chibi manages to get himself away, and the rest of Arrow Gaming, I think, lucky to keep the other two heroes alive. Great initiation there from Scythe. Lance almost catching out Miracle. Oh, Sunstrike! Miracle drops down to no health, gets off another armlet toggle, and another one after that. And Lance, if he sticks around for too long, he's going to be caught here. Pelosin attempts a blink, he's going to miss that one. Force that forward, now finds the stun, and Lance pays for his greediness. He could taste the Lycan blood on that one, but he just could not quite get the kill as Miracle. Not gonna say expertly micro the armlet, but he did well. That wasn't some clutch armlet play by any means. He was just, frankly, quite lucky that the Sunstrike did not kill him. Oh, another Sunstrike! Oh my god! Chibi and Miracle somehow group up together at that last second, and poor DDZ is screwed out of yet another kill. Hits both, brings them both low, but kills neither. And he could use that kill gold, man. Necronomicon 3 is waiting. And they want to try and end this game right now. Death Prophet pushes. He's got the level 2 exorcism. He's very tanky at this point in time. If they just had a Necro Book 3, they would have all the pushing power they could ever ask for. There's some additional items they could wait on. Wait for the BKB. You could have Clockwork having, okay, picking up a full pipe in here in just a few minutes. But they know they have an advantage right now. They're going to try and push for that. Do have, you can see Chibi is on the side waiting for an arrow, which is going to be going in. Not landing, though. Pelosin trying to force Lance back, and that's going to be going into Miracle, who pops a BKB and immediately starts going for Matera once again. The Cogs is not going to be able to put a stop to him this time, as he does get the bash necessary to be able to finish off that critical Enigma kill. Chibi now turns around, gets a Nice little arrow there onto Lance Pelosin. Two-man stomp on top of the Sky Wrath Mage Ultimate, and now here comes the Meteor. Pelosin gets low, not quite low enough, though, as the Death Prophet unable to finish him off. Right clicks onto Kopi, but it's just support here. Meanwhile, DDZ is being comboed on the back as Chibi takes him out, and Lance, one of the last heroes left alive for Arrow, is going to be taken out as Pelosin gets a greedy stun, but is able to get away at the last second. Clockwork, though, does claim the kill. Nicely placed rocket there. And Zhang Zai, the last member alive for Arrow who is alive. Chibi's going to find him here, but I simply do not think it's possible that Chibi wins this man fight. Maybe he does. Arrow goes out. Whoa, it misses! Chibi! Throwing the game here with an attempt at a kill on Zhang Zai. Misses a point blank arrow. That was not a glitch. There was 0 points of damage that was laid down from a maxed out arrow. That was a straight up miss. Sometimes you have that graphical glitch when the arrow will appear to go straight through, and because it's a 0.1 second stun, but there was no damage laid out from that arrow. So it just straight up missed.
The billions of night enfold me.
Oh man, Chibi. Hey, he's been having a great game, I would say, so far. He's landed some very clutch arrows. Key points, catching out that Death Prophet in the river was one of the best of them. He's had great back and forth movement in the team fights. As a whole, Scythe have been utilizing the Moonlight Shadow very well in order to de-aggro. And that's one of the keyest parts about a Death Prophet. Its exorcism is so easy to be able to kite around if you have a good ability like Moonlight Shadow. Once again, we're going to see Miracle maybe attempt to come in from behind Moonlight Shadow. And now the attempt to go. Pipe is going to be used. Three-man stun from Pelosin. That's a beautiful start, but the pipe puts a stop to a lot of that magic damage. Miracle is going to be going for heroes in the back. DDZ, and there goes the black hole. He caught out Miracle and Chibi, but it's going to be stopped by the Chain Frost. MTR, he's going to go down. Miracle, oh, Pelosin's trapped inside the cogs, but he's got two. With the stomp, he lays down a good amount of magic damage before he goes down, but simply put, there's just not enough to finish him off, and now Arrow Gaming. Even if they don't have exorcism, they have more than enough zoo on the field. Look at that, the Forge Spirits, the Dire Eidolons. They've got everything needed to be able to take this middle tower. And Arrow Gaming, look, warmed up, man. I mean, it's been some sloppy play on both sides, but Arrow Gaming executing much, much better than they did in game one, and really comes down to a better draft.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Tier 1 tower, one hit left. There goes. Tier 3 tower taken out by the Death Prophet.
Radiant's courier has been
killed. Being taken out, but Arrow Gaming just looking for a clean extraction now. And Scythe, they need some pickups. They already lost their middle tier 1, their middle racks. They need to be able to claim a couple of kills off of this one. Zhang Zai looks to be their target. Oh ho ho! Zhang Zai! Did he just get himself out? Chibi, with the ultimate coming out, needs to land an arrow here. Zhang Zai attempts to dodge it, but hey. Clockwork was almost guaranteed to be dead when he was at this point 100% dead. He made that clutch hookshot play, forced out a Centaur ultimate. They still only lost one. I mean, that is a good extraction from Arrow Gaming, who were able to take a team fight, take the middle racks, also take the bottom tier 3 tower, and only lose a Clockwork in exchange for it.
Roshan has fallen to the Dire.
Still, though, whenever you give any room to a Lycan, and he's on the Dire side, you know what he's going to do. Take Roshan. He's going to have an Abyssal Blade soon. That spells trouble. Even though Arrow just took the mid-racks, and you're feeling very good about their positioning in this team fight right now, I bet they even have quite a bit of a gold lead. 3,000 gold lead, not as much as expected. Scythe, ooh, Jesus, look at that experience lead. Good God. So even though the mid-racks is down, and you got to be feeling happy if you're an Arrow Gaming fan that they finally successfully made a good push and a great team fight. At the same time, notice what Miracle has been doing every single team fight. He pops his ultimate. He will sometimes pop his BKB, and he goes straight for that Enigma. And he tries to force out a one-man black hole because he knows he's tanky enough to be able to survive the onslaught of many different heroes targeting him while he's disabled. And this is made even easier by the fact he now has an Abyssal. There is a strong possibility that if the Enigma does not immediately black hole the Lycan when he comes forward, that he will get Abyssaled and bashed down from there. And that could very easily be a one team fight. He does have a Ghost Scepter. Attempted initiation, though, not going to be found. Arrow, DDZ. Oh, Chibi just got caught by that one. Matero, he's going to be falling here as the rest of Arrow Gaming leave him behind. There it is. Ruts done. Excellent blind arrow there from Chibi that was able to catch out the Enigma, so at least it gave them something for that full rotation that they just had in the bottom lane. And Scythe, I think if they're smart, they're going to go for some five-man pushes of their own. No longer let Arrow Gaming dictate the course of these teamfights. Because when you're one lane racks down, you're at a big disadvantage, but you can still easily come back. When you're two racks down, oftentimes, that's where you have the GG calls. Because a two racks down, even 60 minutes into this game, Arrow Gaming would still have a gigantic advantage because they'd only have to worry about one lane. They would just have to sit top, bit by bit, chip and chip and chip until the tier 3 tower fell, and then the range racks fell, and then an all-man commit into the melee racks. So Scythe cannot allow Arrow Gaming to be able to take control of this map and go for another 5-man push bottom. If they're smart, they'll force team fights on their own terms. And I think that's why Scythe are grouping up so much. They're pushing in this middle lane, trying to keep it in front of the river at all times. Bottom lane has been pushed out decently well. And this is a good opportunity for them to go for a pickoff here, whether it's a Dust, a Moonlight Shadow, hell, even just utilizing the Invis rune to scout somebody. Or maybe even go for a tier 2 tower in the mid lane. Not quite what I expected, seeing as they're dealing with these mega creeps. Or super creeps, rather.
Radiant's middle tower.
But I guess they just want money.
Radiant structures are fortified.
I don't think they'll be able to go for the uphill push. They'll have to get back.
Radiant's
right
middle
away.
Tower has fallen.
Miracle does not have a TP. Pelosin, well, he just found a stun onto the Death Prophet, and Arrow Gaming actually, in the game of pushing chicken, Arrow Gaming blinked. I don't think that should have had Vix. Reedom is going to turn around onto Lance, lay down whatever damage he can. Good force staff over the top, and they actually blow him up. Miracle takes down the Death Prophet. The bounce around Death Prophet ultimate, or Lich ultimate, does a lot. Oh, beautiful. Two-man stun from Pelosin on the backside as well, which should give the rest of his allies enough time to be able to get out. MTR may go for the black hole here, but it's just going to be an Aegis. Scythe, if they can win this team fight, it's going to be up to Pelosin to find the initiation. Gets Moze in, the arrow comes in. Can it find another one? It gets DDZ! And that's what they needed! Scythe, if they can get this black hole being laid down, but there's not a whole lot of damage coming out from them just yet. Miracle's still healthy, Pelosin getting out. Chibi comes in from behind, and he's now going to start focusing on Matero, who does get stunned. That should be the end of the Enigma. Meanwhile, Death Prophet has come back in, but he doesn't have exorcism. Not much he can do. DDZ being chased out by Chibi. Chibi, can he land this arrow here? DDZ has no escape from that one. The arrow does land, takes him out. Lance trying to go for the kill on the Centaur, but he's too tanky for him to aggro down. Hookshot is going to be able to find X-Freedom. Good enough exchange. Pelosin. Yeah, X-Freedom still going to be caught out.
My death means nothing.
They just need to make sure they don't lose anybody else.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Still, that was a great team fight for them. They forced a buyback on the clockwork and only lost a Skywrath Mage in exchange for it. They just need to continue to hold on to the map, and they've got 25 seconds where they have an advantage. It's an Invoker in exchange for a Skywrath Mage are down. Scythe need to be taking some map control back because the bottom lane was already pushing. Middle is naturally going to push. Top lane as well already had the momentum going its way. So Scythe need to push these side lanes out once again, push out the middle lane, and continue to go for this. Because Arrow Gaming, even if they win a team fight in these scenarios, like that was a great team fight for Scythe, but even if Arrow did win that, they wouldn't have Exorcism. They wouldn't have Black Hole. They wouldn't have a quick way to be able to take a set of racks off of them. And that's why I keep saying Scythe should not allow Arrow Gaming to be the dictators of the team fight. They shouldn't allow them to five-man through bottom and try and defend at their racks. When you're dealing with push strats like this, oftentimes the best thing you can do, and you could see it here, they're going to go for a fight right in this area. They've already laid down the preemptive ward. They're going to try and wrap around and catch out Arrow Gaming from behind. They seem to be slightly delayed.
Shadows take us.
They don't seem to quite know what they're going for here. Running forward. Miracle's going to be the first to reveal, and he goes straight for the throw. Goes for Molson, takes him out instantly. Now, Metero. He's going to be the next target. He doesn't have a black hole, actually. DDC copping a huge amount of damage. There goes the Enigma, and DDC falls. Exorcism is up for Lance, but he's already on the retreat. There's not much they can do. Arrow Gaming, I think they're going to lose a Rax off of this one. Lance is clearly dead. That's a five-man wipe. Scythe lose nothing in exchange. And they can now just five-man down bottom, take a set of racks, and potentially even go for a second set of racks in the middle lane because they took that tier two about 10 minutes ago.
Dire's bottom barracks are under
smart
attack.
Play here from the Invoker. DDZ using his Necronomicon minions attack to try and threaten a Rax while this middle
Radiant's
push is coming
bottom
in,
tower has fallen.
Which is forces one hero back. Scythe, they're not going for a Rax. They're not even going for a tier three here. They're going to continue to play it safe. They're looking at Miracle going, buddy, you have not died yet. You've got so much farm. 22,000 net worth. Almost doubling that of the Death Prophet. So if he can pick himself up a Scythe of Vice, there's no physical damage that can actually take him out. Like, they black hole him. If he pops his BKB before he gets stuck in the black hole, they can't focus him down. Not fast enough. He's going to have way too much armor. So the physical damage, right-click damage coming out from the Invoker, from the Eidolons, I guess, from the Exorcism, that physical damage is not going to be enough to be able to take out the Lycan. And Lycan, every single time, has had the same game plan, which is try and focus on the supports in the back. Try and go for that Enigma. The Enigma has Black Hole. Try and force him to use a one-man Black Hole. And that'll give my team plenty of opportunity to respond, especially since if Enigma, even if he does go and get himself a BKB, it looks like Matero is completely undecided on what his item is supposed to be. Because that's part of a BKB, that's part of a Lincoln's, and that is just a go set. There goes that one-man black hole. He did pop the BKB, though, and look at that. The physical damage is just not there. He's going to start going for Zhang Zai, four staff out, and he's going to be able to get himself some distance there, but the cold snap holds him in long enough. Now Pelosin dives in to help out his ally, but he just adds more food for the flames. Arrow Gaming, man, that...
Radiant's top tower.
Does he have a buyback? Yes. Lycan does have a buyback. He does not have Shapeshift for another 12 seconds. Exorcism will not be up for this Rax push. But there's no tier 3 tower. So they could still easily claim a Rax here. Arrow comes out. Oh, it caught out Lance, and now the stun on DDZ as well. They're going to turn their attention to Lance first, but he already popped the Exorcism. He's not that high priority of a target just yet. DDZ would be a bit better. Look at that. Chain Frost continues to bounce and bounce and bounce. In the background, Death Prophet has already gone down, but Chain Frost just does not stop for anybody. Zhang Zai, DDZ, both fall. Matero's going to be able to get himself out. The Shadow Demon not quite so lucky. And Matero immediately goes for the push in the top lane, which is already being threatened from just the creep wave. We're going to have Roshan go down here. So Scythe, the buyback on Lycan, well worth it in this regard because Miracle is going to give himself a second life anyway. He's going to sell Vlad's, I guess. Sell Vlad's, pick up the Aegis, or maybe he just gives it to somebody else. I don't think there's anyone more important than this Lycan, though. And sure enough, he drops the Vlad's. Cheese is going to be picked up by the Centaur. A little bit surprised there isn't one of those items, Aegis or the Cheese, going the way of the Marana, considering you now have a Desolator up for her. So she is beginning to get some physical damage to rival the Lycan. It looks a bit overinflated right now because she's got a DD, but Lycan still massively out DPSs her. Eventually. Another arrow, this time catching a Ford Spirit, but Scythe do not seem to care. They start going uphill. Miracle almost losing his Aegis there. In fact, he does. Great defense there from Arrow Gaming. And perhaps a overzealous Miracle trying to push in too early into the base. X Freedom, too bad. Rockets, I suppose, just was not up in time. Items coming up. Is that a Shiva's Guard? Sure enough, it is. Excellent. Excellent pickup for the Centaur. Gets himself a lot of armor, as well as increases the chasing capacity with that Shiva's Guard slow. Mirana could easily build into a Daedalus here if she wants to. Or potentially go for the Butterfly. There could be reasons for both. I like the Daedalus when you go for a Desolator because it gives you that raw damage that you're looking for. At the same time, she has a Manta. Anytime you have a Manta, that's a lot of lost damage that could be going to a Daedalus. You know, your illusions, obviously, not really getting the critical. You're not benefiting. A lot of your damage is coming out from those illusions, so. Butterfly would be nice to be able to deal with some of the Invoker right-clicks, but not as helpful versus the Death Prophet. So, there could be reasons for both. Blink Dagger finally picked up by the Enigma. This game is all on Matero right now, and whether or not he can find that clutch initiation to be able to catch some heroes. And he has to get Miracle plus some heroes. I don't think he can actually just go for the heroes in the back and let Miracle go off on his own because Miracle's hitting too hard. He's hitting for 500 damage a hit plus a critical when he goes into shapeshift form. As well as good lockdown from that Abyssal Blade. Unfortunately, the split push continues. Oh, man. It's a whole different kind of rat here. It's the pack rat. Arrow Gaming, do not... Oh, nice. This is where you want to use a black hole. Catching two heroes out. Chibi should be going down. Yeah, yeah. He's going to be caught. Perfect. They might have just secured the game there with that one black hole. In fact, I think they did. There's going to be a buyback from the Mirana, but no buyback from the Centaur. That's why he was given the cheese, by the way.
And it's off.
Miracle is going to be coming in from behind once again. It's going to be a 4v5 fight without their melee initiator. So it's going to be tough to find those openings. Comes in, immediately Scythe buys. He has to try and make his way out. Turns around, starts going for Molson. He's going to be able to lock him down real quickly. Skywrath Mage Ultimate over the top as well. Chain Frost starts bouncing around. Matero cops a good amount of magic damage from that one. Lance on the front lines. Already been able to take a good chunk of damage away from Scythe and force them back. So they do defend. One for one. Ooh, close Sunstrike. Wouldn't have killed Miracle. Would have put him low, though. Oh, looks like I got word. Kopi is actually the old Kai from First Departure. So. So, known stand-ins on both sides. Clockwork. Zhang Zai. Does he go for a BKB here in order to deal with the magic damage that's being spread out, spread around from the Timber Saw as well as the Skywrath Mage? Like, Skywrath is... Cogs is just an invitation for you to drop a Mystic Flare. So, does he go for a BKB here? Or is this potentially a Halberd in order to deal with the Lycan? Because we're running on a very short BKB time now. Centaur ultimate going off there, looking for a pickoff with this smoke. Mosin, he's in range, I think, for this Blink Dagger. Plosin does get the stun. This is a simple pickoff. Just a support for now. Arrow Gaming, this is fine if they can manage to get themselves out of this teamfighter. Maybe even a force a good one. Miracle is going to be locked inside of the cogs. Lance comes forward, starts laying down some of that physical damage. Miracle is forced to pop the BKB as the Meteor comes in. Whoa, Plosin pops the cheese there. Brought himself super low with the double edge, killing the melee Necronomicon. But Guess he just wanted an excuse to pop the cheese. 22-37, 44 minutes into this game, we have an 8,000 gold lead for Scythe over a 30,000, almost 35,000 experience lead. I mean, that is just an insane. Look at the levels. 12, 14, 16, 24, 22. It's because Scythe are obviously winning many more of these team fights. They're coming out on top of most of them. The problem is they lost so much gold to some of these early pushes. And they're losing more and more gold to buybacks as well. And that's why they don't have a gigantic gold lead like they do experience. Still ahead, though. Still large and in charge. Scythe Gaming are controlling much of this map. It's up to Arrow to try and find that one pickoff that'll lead them into five-manning into the base once again, taking off that melee Rax, and then they can focus on just one lane.
Illusion.
Team fights are getting harder and harder for Arrow Gaming, though. There is the Crystallis into the Daedalus pickup for Chibi. Big fan. Matero. He's looking for an excuse to pop his black hole right now, but unfortunately a solo Lycan is not enough for him. He needed something better. Satanic. Miracle picked up his Vlads once again after dropping that in exchange for the Aegis. He grabs his Vlads, but is going to be... Whoa! Okay. All right. Well, that was odd. Apparently I said Timbersaw at some point in time in the cast. I don't even remember. I don't ever remember those words coming out of my mouth. It's one hell of a game, though. I mean, this is close as hell. And hopefully we won't be delayed too long by the terrible, terrible server problems that we're having right now when everybody getting kicked out. I don't know when I said Timbersaw. I have no recollection of those words coming out of my mouth at any point in time, but the play-by-play has been not quite as smooth as it should be, so I wouldn't be surprised whatsoever. Good Lord, please don't tell me this is happening. Check in with the admin, see if hopefully it's just a couple of us that are out of the game. But as I was saying, Satanic is going to be picked up by the Lycan soon, so he's going to be able to have a large amount of sustainability. Now, he still has to deal with a lot of kiting issues, and he may consider going for a new BKB if he becomes too much of an issue, but he's being blocked out by Cogs. He has to deal with Black Hole, with Hookshot, none of those things which BKB can help you with, but it can help you deal with some of the magic damage that is floating around during those times you're being held. For example, the Meteor is a big threat when you have a maxed out Exord Invoker. So, if he can just weather the storm throughout all of those disables... And finally, once the disables are over with, get onto somebody with a Satanic, start getting that health back. He should be unkillable from there. Problem is, he has no way to be able to deal with those kiting things besides just weathering the storm, right? He has no way to be able to get out of Cogs effectively. Like, he can attack the Cogs, but it's a slow process. Hook shot, guaranteed hit. Black hole, nothing he can do about, that's entirely up to his team. Like, Miracle's been doing everything he can to try and target the Enigma to force the use of bad black holes. But when the black hole is used, it's still up to the Lich to put a stop to that one. Yeah, it looks like everyone's DCing, including myself, so we may have to go for a load game. Good lord. Dropping the fury on DDZ. Try one more reconnect, and I think if this does not work, we will be going for a load game. Hopefully we didn't miss anything. I don't think anything critical happened in the last 30 seconds. So. You said Timber Saw when discussing the magic damage on Scythe and whether or not Clock would go for a BKB. Did I really? Skywrath Mage and Centaur. Not Timber Saw. Good lord. Not Timber Saw. Anyway. Timber Saw would be pretty legit for them, though. So Skywrath Mage and Centaur and all that magic damage. Which is why he may go for a BKB, because we're about to have an Aghanim Scepter up for the Skywrath Mage, which, again, you put yourself in cogs, you're just begging for a Skywrath Mage to be thrown down. But if he was afraid of the magic damage, I would much rather see him go for the Blade Mail and just be like, just fingers, just middle finger out to the Skywrath Mage. Like, you can kill me, but I'll kill you back. All right. I think we're gonna have to load. Da 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 da. Anyway, so I'm betting on a halberd just because the Lycan is such a big threat that at this point in time I'd expect him, because the BKB is only down to 4 seconds. If they can just hold the Lycan down, he pops his BKB, you black hole him or hookshot cogs him or something from there. Then you can wait until the Lycan is actually able to get on somebody again before you fully halberd him. Plus, they increase the survivability of Clockwork by a ton. What? There we go. Mercy game. All right. We are going to be loading the game. So we have lost 20 seconds. So nothing has happened. So don't worry. Everything will be back on track. And maybe there'll be a bug and somebody will load a Timber Saw. Give Timber Saw. Now we just need the players to actually join the game. Oh, man. I really don't want to cut this VOD. I really do not want to cut this VOD, so we are going to go to a break. We're not going to play any music. By God, these players will get into the lobby, and we will start. Madota. My DOTA experiences being ruined by this pause. Whoa, sorry. Just random JD intro. Casual, don't worry. Hopefully we don't have too many bugs, because loading games is always very buggy. Creep waves don't spawn. There's usually at least one creep wave that doesn't spawn. Sometimes there are certain spells that are no longer on cooldown when they were. But considering that nothing happened in the last 20 seconds of the game, I think we should be happy that that is all that is going to be going on. Why not just watch the game we DC'd from? Because why the hell not? Oh, look, it's me in my dead perspective. So we can go over items. That's what we can do. Nice. I'm such a smart guy. Look at that. Aghanim Scepter already finished up. So Skywrath Mage, no cooldown on that ultimate. He can drop bombs whenever he wants to. Centaur, BKB for him soon. Daedalus for the Marana soon. Invoker. They're not here yet. Invoker has a Necronomicon 3, a Scythe of Ice, as well as a 4 staff plus another 2,300 gold. He may have to consider going a Ghost Scepter here, as well as buyback money. There's the clockwork that we had so many issues with discussing. Our Enigma. So at one point in time, he did have an Ogre Club. He forsook that in exchange for a TP scroll, and he is going to be going for a Lincoln's, it looks like, before he opts for the... What? What the hell? All right. All right, we're now going to be casting this from Dota TV, since apparently the player is loaded into the game eventually. So we got some Dota cast now, boys. Let's do it, Dota TV style. So apologies to those of you who were watching in Dota TV, had this DC, and maybe were checking out the stream to see what was wrong. If you want to hear my exquisite commentary about the timber saw in this game, you're gonna have to watch on the stream. So apologies all around. At least the chat is going ham. At least the chat is going ham. Oh man, Miracle is still where's your courier? It's dead. Why is it dead? Why is the Oculopos dead? Unbelievable. All right, so Miracle's a long ways away from that Satanic because presumably he is going to want to hold on to his buyback. And in which case, he still needs a lot more gold. He needs a good 3,000 more gold before he can buy a straight-up Satanic and still have enough for a buyback, if not more. Hopefully, yeah, I think the players are currently waiting on the admin decision, which should have been made already, and now we're just waiting for the 2-minute delay to catch up. So hopefully this pause will only last a minute or more, and the game will start, and we'll be casting it. All right, there it is. Nice. See, Helga's all over it. Our admin, Helga. He told them to go. After the 2-minute delay, we are now set to rock and roll. So, who has buyback? Who does not have buyback based on timer? Murana. So, Chibi may consider going for a straight Daedalus here with the money he currently has. He just needs another 200 and he can buy the Daedalus. Seeing as he doesn't have a buyback for another minute anyway, if Arrow Gaming for go for a 5-man push, he may feel like, oh god, I need the damage right now. I'm not going to have a buyback anyway, so let's just go ahead and do it. But it doesn't look like Arrow's going to go for that push. Arrow sitting back. I mean, they are certainly on the timer, but... casual Forge Spirits walking into the base, seeing if they could hit the melee racks a couple times. That's just not going to happen. I wonder why Lycan, I mean, I suppose if you bought the Halberd. I don't think the Helm of Dominator, you replace the Helm of Dominator with the Vlad's. Vlad's is better because it gives you that extra damage. And I suppose the Reaver you wouldn't replace for anything on here. So I guess it's fine, the build. It's just odd for you to be going for the recipe first. First recipe, then Helmadom, then Reaver. So I'm not sure what Arrow going to be waiting on here. If it's them waiting for a smoke, that's what it is. Smoke is smoke. Full Daedalus bought out by GD. He He did have a buyback, though, based on timer. He no longer has it based on gold, though. So this could be a critical mistake here if he gets caught out. But Arrow Gaming, not going to be going for it just yet. Lance is pushing in the middle lane as much as possible. Well, the rest of the four, see what they're expecting here. What they're expecting here is Chibi expects the rest of the four to be behind that death prop, but instead, he's going to be caught here in the bottom lane. A big bluff there from Arrow Gaming, who left Lance all alone in this middle lane. Easily could have been caught, but the presumption was by Scythe that the rest of the four heroes of Arrow Gaming were right behind him. And now, Mirana does not have a buyback and will not be in this team fight for another 90 seconds.
There it goes.
This is a huge loss. This is a huge loss for Scythe, and that might have just cost them the game. See if they're able to defend. Oh, Tornado actually catches out the two. Pelosin tries to hit the stun, but he's not going to be able to land it. Hitting Scythe up by stump, he's not even going to be able to get off the stun. Gets taken out before anything else happens. Meanwhile, Freedom is being chased away. Miracle's coming in from behind. He's going to start going for those supports. Goes for Rosen first. Now targets the next one, which is going to be the Enigma. Gets the Abyssal Bash and will be able to finish him off. Two supports down. Goes on for the next one. His BKB has run out, though. And now he is trapped. He can't really go anywhere. He's dealing with the Exorcism. He finishes off Lance. A third one goes down. Miracle goes for a fourth. Zhang Zai is able to finish him off. Now it's 1v1. Him against the Invoker, he should be fine. DDZ is going to back himself up. It was a great win for Arrow Gaming. Oh, Miracle! Can he toggle this armor? Not going to be able to do it. DDZ just finished off the Lycan by canceling his teleport and going for the kill. I don't know what else to say about that. Just sheer throws there. So Scythe, they do beat back Arrow Gaming, but they just lost a melee Rax, which is the important Rax for the bottom lane. Oh, Freedom. Freedom, Freedom, Freedom. DDZ, he's going to try and backdoor this. He's going to wait for the middle lane's going to push. Once he gets to about here, the backdoor protection is gone. And he's going to go for it. I think the backdoor protection is off right now. It is. He's going to go for the tier 3 with the Necronomicon. And he lays down a good 300 to 400 damage. Not bad at all. Force some rotations. Excellent play.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
And Arrow Gaming have one simple objective in here. It's just Siege. It sieges the top lane. Siege it until the tier 3 has fallen. Siege it until the ranged Rax has fallen after that, and then go for a full five-man push and just focus down that melee Rax. As long as you have buybacks, you're going to be able to get yourself mega creeps, plus you just buy back a defender your base, and Scythe will eventually lose the game.
John.
But that's why Scythe need to make a desperate play here. They're going to go for Roshan right away. Chibi does not have the gold for a buyback. He needs this Aegis. He's going to sell his bottle, teleport up to the top lane, and have an Aegis in hand for the next team fight. This is going to be Cheese as well, which is going to go to Pelosin. Notice Pelosin doesn't have a team move score. X Freedom does. Kobe does not. Miracle's going to be on the front lines, but this could be a good opportunity for Arrow to lay down a good amount of damage on this tier 3. Oh, Force Staff 4 plus the Scythe device. That was a critical play there, but it's just going to cost them the Centaur ultimate. Already Lance has blown his ultimate. Whoa! Pelosin should not be forcing this fight while the Exorcism is up. It's unnecessary at this point. Let the Exorcism wear itself out.
Incoming!
Scythe, oh, we're gonna have Miracle trying to go in. He's gonna try and find DDZ. He's not gonna be able to finish him off, but already the Enigma as well as the Shadow Demon have been taken out. Mirana's gonna come in from the side, not able to catch the rest of the heroes. They're just gonna content themselves with the Clockwork pickoff. Three heroes go down for nothing. As it goes to show, the power of Scythe is still well in hand. They can still win these team fights really easily, but when it comes to splitting up is where they're actually left exposed, and that's where Pelosin may get picked off. Nice four staff away. DDZ doing everything he can to punish Scythe when they have to go back to base and defend. Another disconnection. Everybody is holding on to buyback gold at this point in time. DDZ is going to be going for a refresher eventually, but he has to hold on to buyback gold, so it's unlikely he'll pick it up in the next couple of minutes. I'm still presuming this is going to be a Lincoln's pickup eventually for the Enigma, because just to stop that Chain Frost. To get Lincoln's and a BKB, he is unstoppable when he lays down that black hole. But it's a rough ass, man. This Enigma is, they're putting so much into pushing that they're not actually gaining any gold anymore, because they push, they die. They push, they die. They push, they die. The only heroes are gaining anything off of this is the Invoker, who's managed to survive through most of these team fights, and maybe the Death Prophet. Death Prophet's been holding on to a bit of cold hard cash here, 3,600 gold in the bank. Could sell the drums, pick up a heart, conceivably. Would be one of my go-to items. Anything to increase the survivability of a Death Prophet. I would love to see DDZ finish up a refresher, though. I mean, it's always amazing having a refresher Invoker, but when you get the chance to see it from a player like DDZ, it's going to be amazing. It's going to be amazing, but he might not be able to pick it up in time. Centaur really needs that BKB. You saw the last time that he tried to go in this bottom lane where he just got kited so heavily between the Scythe of Ice, the Cog Burns, whatever it was, Cold Snap even. He was never able to get off a good Hoof Stomp. And that's all he is at this point in time. It's just if he can catch two or three heroes in a Hoof Stomp in just one, that's all he needs in a team fight. Just one, he has done his job. We could have a full-out refresher here for DDZ right now, but that would leave him exposed with no buyback gold. So he's going to farm up a little bit more. There goes that Vlad's disappeared and is now going to be taken over by this Satanic for Miracle. Arrow have plenty of options here. If they choose to do so, they can easily go through mid into the top lane. They can just keep middle pushed and also push out the top lane at the same time. Miracle is also grabbing himself a Boots of Travel. He's had that, I believe, for a little bit. Dyer's but this is going to allow him that even if they win the team fight, he can instantly go to start split pushing and maybe claim a Rax off.
Top tower has fallen.
So that's his big offensive pickup. This is how they're going to get out of this rut of being two racks down and constantly clustered inside of their base. We had one defensive team fight, teleport out to the side lane that you have pushed.
Rock it on.
And that's why it's so critical for Miracle to keep this bottom lane pushed out. Wow, they're really going for this. Smoke rotation. Arrow is not going to be able to find anybody.
Dyer's middle
and now, I mean, it's pretty obvious. When you have two racks down like this, and when at least one of the mid lane, this mid lane constantly pushing it, if no one's defending, it's obviously
Dyer's
a smoke
rotation. Dyer's top barracks are under attack.
And that's why Arrow Gaming backed themselves up. Heart is picked up for the Death Prophet. Refresher. Come on, DDZ. You've got enough money, I think, now. You just farm up a little bit extra. You'll have 2K in the bank if you buy that refresher recipe now. Farm up maybe just a little bit more to ensure you have a buyback. I want to see it, I believe. Rod of Atos is going to be grabbed here for X Freedom. It's a pretty late one, but it is a strong survivability item for the Skywrath Mage, and the extra slows can do wonders for ensuring your Mystic Flare does the appropriate amount of damage. They have some time while this bottom lane is pushing. That Scythe are going to try and utilize that to keep the top lane pushed with the illusions coming out from the Mirana. And Miracle, just five manning down mid. If he's not careful, though, he can easily be caught out. You can see the Tornado EMP already doing some work to Miracle. but he certainly has enough sustainability to keep himself on the front lines. Chibi trying to go for a clutch 5-second arrow, but he's not going to find it just yet. Yeah, they could very easily burn away most of Miracle's mana here, and if he doesn't have a shapeshift, he's not much use in teamfight. Centaur ultimate popped a little bit preemptively there, and, well, they have to go back soon. That bottom lane, that is way too large of a creep wave for them to just let it be. Tornado almost catching out one of those heroes. Moonlight Shadow is going to be used by Chibi to make sure they do successfully get themselves out. Notice that the Lycan is not using his Boots of Travel to get back in base right away. This is going to be them doing a sort of fake back where they may catch out DDZ. Do they have the vision? They see him for a second, slow him down, and now Miracle gets in range. Can he get a bash? He never got the Abyssal Blade off, and that's going to be critical. He didn't catch him out. Now he's going to try and go onto Lance right away. His BKB is going to run out soon. Here comes that black hole. Catches out Miracle. Miracle will be losing his life here as well as the two supports on the side. Exorcism comes in, cleans up another one. X Freedom on his way out. The buyback immediately comes out from the Lich. Lycan, though, he does have a buyback, but he's not ready to use it just yet. Comes in. Centaur cleans up. DDZ, nicely done by him. He's going to go for Zhang Zai yet. Can't be sticking around too much, though. He doesn't have the burst damage to finish him off. Chibi, meanwhile, gets a solid arrow onto Lance, but it's not going to be enough. Now he's thrown up in the air. Silence not landing, and Chibi actually makes his leap away. That silence had landed. There was a chance Lance could have turned and finished off the Murana, who was so low already. Great team fight there from Scythe. It started very poor with Miracle unable to get his Abyssal Blade strike onto the Invoker. I think he was just trying to hold on to it, thinking they would be able to ensure the kill onto the Invoker without needing to use that bash. But that was obviously not the case. With this buyback, though, look at the number of buybacks on the Radiant side. If Miracle oversteps his bounds and tries to go for the straight win and gets caught out by too many buybacks, that will be a game-losing play right there. You're going to have what is essentially a 5-9. Miracle starts making that initiation, gets a bash onto Molson, takes him out immediately. Starts focusing on the tier 3 rather than going for the clockwork. It's going to be pushed back by the cogs. Meanwhile, Centaur's buying a lot of time for his team. They're already taking that tier 3. Miracle's getting low as he starts focusing on the racks, but they're going to be forced back here in a second. Miracle, Scythe advised up, and the rest of Scythe. Bad drop of the Skywrath Mage ultimate there. Pelosa makes another initiation, pops the BKB. Lich ulti starts bouncing around, and Scythe got to get out of here. They are lucky to be able to take the tier 3, and if they can get everybody else out, that is a win for them. But somebody's going to get caught here. DDZ is too fast. He's going to catch out X Freedom. Slows him down a little bit. Silence. Meanwhile, the Centaur goes back in. He's going to be able to catch out Zhang Zai. Chibi gets him with a nice last hit. Critical. Centaur's going to fall in exchange. Lich will also go down as the Exorcism will be able to force him out. Miracle's coming in. He's low, but he's going to go for the kill. He's going to go straight for Lance to try and take him out. The Ghost Scepter goes up. Now he's caught inside the cogs. Exorcism will be going off for just a second, but Chibi finishes off that critical Death Prophet play. Miracle now left alive to go up against Zhang Zai next to Chibi. They can conceivably get a mid-rax here, but remember the buybacks that are going to come into play here. DDZ does not have his Chibi. May tick out. He takes out from the urn. Mosin takes him out. Big damage dealer gone, and now the rest of Scythe Gaming will have to teleport themselves back to base where they've already lost a tier 4 and almost a second one as well. 60 minutes into this game. Arrow Gaming versus Scythe, 31-52. We have gold lead, 15,000 for Scythe, and over a 40,000 experience lead, but this means very, very little in this previous point. What really matters is the buybacks. We only have two available buybacks for either side, and they are on some inconsequential heroes. Centaur is not the hero you want to have your one buyback on. Enigma's okay, but he doesn't have a Boots of Travel. So if Arrow Gaming do go for a push and somehow the Enigma dies before he gets off a black hole, he won't be able to buy back and immediately be back for the team fight. So that's why I'm going to call him inconsequential as well. There are certain situations where that buyback can still be very useful. If they trade one for one, the Enigma for someone else, and they manage to buy back, run their way all the way across the map, and still be there in time while that other hero is down, it'll be worth it. But as it stands right now, it's going to come to one final clash. And that clash may be around Roshan. Roshan is up. Cheese is available. Aegis and Cheese available for the taking. But what team wants to do it right now? That is not going to be Lincoln's. The other possibility was a Scythe, and that is what Nigma's going to be going. More right-click disable. So his black hole is still going to be canceled constantly, either by Chain Frost or some other stun or silence. But at least he has a nice hard disable to add in next to the Invoker. Miracle. Oh, trying to wrap around a little bit there, but they don't go for it. Pelos is going to be caught by the Scythe of Ice, and this is no good. Pelosin, this could be a free pickoff. Nice force staff, and actually Zhang Zai is going to be the one who goes down. Ghost after the last second. We'll be able to save him. Exorcism has been used, though. Oh, there it is. Nicely done. X-Freedom stuck around just to be able to drop that Skywrath Mage ultimate to finish off the clockwork. What originally started to be a free pickoff on the Centaur. Double force staff ends up saving his life, and it's actually the clockwork who falls instead. Matero no longer has a buyback, by the way, with his Scythe of Ice pickup. Pelosin. Always being... They've had such good communication with their Force Staff, though, because Pelosin can sit so far forward, they don't have enough to hold them against Force Staff. That's why he has one himself. Chibi's going to start going for that Aegis. Oh, no. Oh, no. Arrow Gaming, they have to know Roshan is up. They revealed it earlier with the Sunstrike, but they're not defending the Rosh Pit. Critical seconds have already gone by where Chibi has been able to take the Roshan down to below a quarter of health, and there's no way. DDZ can't get here in time. Roshan Aegis goes the way of the Marana. Cheese picked up by the Centaur. Now DDZ is going to be caught out! That could be it right there. DDZ with no buyback. Aegis, Cheese, both being picked up by Scythe. They can end this game right now, and with that pickoff as well, Enigma with no buyback. What hope do they have without a black hole? In one swoop, this went from being an exceptionally even game to all of a sudden a very anticlimactic finish, potentially. Now, they still have 50 seconds left for Enigma and the Invoker. I don't think Scythe can end the game right now, but they sure as hell can even up the racks. They can take mid racks, and they can take bottom racks. What Arrow need to make sure they do, nobody gets picked off. Nobody can afford to be picked off right now.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Arrow's going to come out, not landing on Lance. Pelosin does come forward. Nice use of the Force Staff. Pelosin gets low, but pops the cheese just in case. Miracle working his way on those racks. Glyph is going to be able to buy them a lot of time. Same time, Chibi is taking that bottom lane as well.
Radiant's bottom barracks are under
Pelosin tries the reinitiation. They need to be able to finish off that death drop, but they can't quite get him. Chibi may get caught in this bottom lane. Silence does go off this time. He will be able to finish off the Aegis. Miracle does get out the bash onto Lance, but there goes that Ghost Scepter. The ghosts start coming back, and Lance loses damage, but gains a lot of health. Meanwhile, the clockwork is taken out by X-Freed. A beautiful play by him. Chibi goes forward, finds Matero, and this could be good, but Chibi's just been Scythe of Ice up. He's going to be taken out before he can do anything. There goes the double meatball. Pelosin on his way out. Matero comes in. Where's the black hole? He only gets X Freedom. That's only one. He needed more there. He needed to be able to catch out Pelosin. Meanwhile, we have Miracle. He's going for Megas. He's trying to finish off this Mega. He's trying to get that tier 3, but he's not going to get it in time. Now he's going to be caught by the disruption. Miracle, he might have just made a precious misplay here as he pops his BKB and teleports away. He does successfully get out. Lich is going to be caught out. Pelosin successfully gets the Enigma kill, but he's going to go down. Oh! Blink, right click, Shiva's going to be able to take him out. So, in the end, Scythe lose a lot of heroes. They do even up the racks lead here. So one last team fight is all it's going to take for them to be able to finish off the game. They're all dead, but they have a lot of buybacks. The critical one is going to be the Marana, who is up in 15 seconds for a buyback, but unfortunately, is still 1,000 gold off the mark.
The crowd shall cheer my name once more.
Lycan will have double lives. Lich can also buy back, and they need to do it soon. DDZ. Oh, good force staff away. Pelosin tries to find that initiation once again. good lord. There is no other real stats. We could talk about some potential item pickups, but I think we've already discussed all of the big ones. I don't think anybody has really picked up anything much. We never mentioned the Butterfly. Rod of Atos was finished by X Freedom. Butterfly for Chibi. But really just comes down to the execution of this last push for Arrow. Can they actually successfully get Megas off of this? Going up against Double Lycan and now Chibi, who is full up.
Dire's middle tower.
And I don't think they can. DDZ successfully finishes off that last tier 4, but exposes himself and does fall. He does have a buyback, so it's worth it for him to make that play, but it leaves the throne exposed. Scythe, they can win team fights left and right here. So you see Miracle cleans through the Shadow Demon real quickly. Nice jump away with the hook shot.
Make no mistake.
Invoker buys back, immediately starts pushing pressure on the bottom lane. Between the throne being exposed and Megas potentially picked up in just a couple of seconds. Both these racks are so damn squishy at this point in time. Just DDZ with a couple of seconds can clean at least a melee racks up. So the bottom always pushing in, top always left exposed for mega creeps potentially. Scythe Gaming are going to need to find an opening, a pickoff here. Otherwise, Arrow Game will systematically split push and rat them to death. And if necessary, sit back and outfarm them for a little while. Wait for those buybacks to be up. They need gold for 4 heroes to have buybacks. Another 5 minutes for DDZ to have a buyback, but I'm not sure if they want to wait a full 5 minutes. Chibi needs to farm up for him to have a buyback. He's going to need it in just another 800 gold is what he needs. So we are going to get one last brawl. Surprisingly enough, it's going to be Scythe who are going to be the aggressors. I really thought that Arrow Gaming were going to be the ones controlling this map and keeping that constant pressure in the bottom lane, which would force Scythe back, but it doesn't seem to be the case. That bottom lane is not pushing fast enough, and Scythe can go straight into the throne. Miracle already popping his ultimate and starts threatening to go for that tier 3. A couple Scythe devices have been used. Arrow lands on Zhang Zai right as he was trying to throw out the hookshot. They forced out Exorcism. Exorcism, much longer cooldown than the Lycan ultimate. If they wanted, they can go back in with the new Lycan ult. They used very little there. We're getting to a point where Death Prophet may have to consider a refresher just because Exorcism being down in a critical team fight could make a big difference. I mean, that's the source of all your damages, Death Prophet, if Scythe of Vice are able to abuse that timing. I mean, you saw the Exorcism was popped so there just because they were so scared of this push at the top lane.
Boom, there it goes.
Four-man push and bottom. But they're going to have to back up for middle, so there's no way Scythe can continue this for any sort of death push. And then why would they go for top, bottom anyway? Top lane appears to be pushing in, but the Forge Spirits will probably make the difference and make the push start going the other way. But that's what the Boots of Travels are all about. And now it's going to be Scythe who start taking control of this map. I mean, you've got the bottom lane pushing in. One person can easily dress middle and top. And Arrow Gaming, I think they just want to rely on their buybacks. They've got a lot of buybacks coming up in a short amount of time.
Players here.
They can play the defense game. They know they can't win straight up team fights. I think the advantage is still going the way of Scythe. So I think that's why they're playing so passive here. Instead of just going all in order to finish off Megas real quick, instead, they're going to try and win a team fight with overwhelming numbers. So when Scythe try and push in with their 5 heroes, Arrow Gaming will have 8 or 9 heroes with buybacks. But this kind of very defensive play leaves yourself open to be outfarmed and also Roshan to be easily taken by Scythe. That's going to be up in just a couple minutes.
Haste.
Smoke gank. Smoke gank for Arrow. just about to say, they need a smoke gank soon because they need to, they can't just give up free Roshan Aegis. Aegis and cheese too much. So they've got a minute and a half to go try and find a pickoff here, but it doesn't look like Scythe are having it. They're sitting back. They're not going to be caught. Item pickups. Lance has 3,700 gold on him. We have the Enigma, who was able to get a Scythe of Ice not too long ago, now has another 2,600 gold on him. Clockwork. Still not using that or cloak for anything. Looks like they found Miracle, but again, the four staffs plus the Centaur ultimate. They have no real strong way to be able to hold these heroes against four staffs. So that's just not going to happen. Yeah, everybody that you're looking at, Chibi. Chibi might be able to grab another item here and still have a buyback and another 3,000 gold or so. Centaur, that's buyback gold. Like it. New BKB being picked up by him, and is this a casual 7th item refresher? I mean, the shapeshift cooldown is super low. Like, the downtime is 18 seconds, 22 seconds. Duration is 18, downtime is 22. But not really sure he's going Orchid either. Miracle, oh, there goes the Black Hole. Matero catches out too here. Chainfrost's gonna be able to interrupt it. And Miracle, can he actually get out of this one? He pops the Satanic, gobbles up a whole bunch of health away from that one. Zhang Zai has to use Disruption for the Shadow Demon to get himself out. They got the Enigma. Black Hole is on cooldown. Miracle did use Shapeshift as well as Satanic, but they can sit back for the next 20 seconds and go for the Death Push. Enigma does have a buyback, but he only has a Midnight Pulse to be able to add to this next team fight. Baiting out the meatball there, Pelosin. Looking for an initiation refresher, and DDZ is going to go for a kill. He's going to try and find Lich, slows him down. Good use of the four staff. Lance pursues, though. They need to utilize this exorcism well. Getting as many kills as humanly possible. They're going to try and clean up the Lich as well as the Centaur, but look at top lane. Miracle's going for that tier 3, but immediately stopped by DDZ. Lance as well teleports in, and they might just get Miracle here. Miracle turns on FTR. He's going to be taken out. Good use of the disruption and the hookshot as well. But this guy, the Wolf Man, they can't take him down. He pops his BKB, teleports away because they have no disables after the hookshot was used and the Black Hole was on cooldown. What else could they do?
Incoming.
Black Hole on cooldown. Double Roshan time.
Poor Roshan.
With a double damage for Chibi, easiest thing in the world. Arrow Man, DDZ. I thought they had actually lost track of the Lycan at that point in time, and I thought they were going to be losing a tier 3, but great play there. Death Prophet as well. Well, even the whole team, but Death Prophet and Invoker were the first ones getting in front of that tier 3 before the Lycan could get there. Almost gave them the opportunity to get that kill. So damn close. Problem is, Scythe are still taking more and more wins out of this. I mean, they lost the Lich, but do you really care about the Lich at this point in time? Like, Ice Armor is great, but if Black Hole isn't up, you don't really care if the Lich is down.
Roshan has fallen
the Lich's only job at this point in time is to give people Lich Armor and then stop the Black Hole. So he doesn't have to buy back. They're at no real disadvantage. Miracle, please show me what you're going to be going doing with his Oblivion staff, because good lord, this is just like Orchid or Refresher. Like, what do? Okay, technically the Invoker does not have an item to stop the Orchid. So he could actually be going a extremely late game Orchid, in which case, why wouldn't you just go for Scythe of Ice? So that's gotta be it. But why would you go Refresher? I don't even know anymore, man. I'm just so puzzled by this Oblivion staff. I mean, like this seventh items. What would you, like if you're going for a seventh item? Wouldn't it be the Manta? That's the classic 7 slot item. Take the Manta, you pop the Manta, you put it back on. Put it back on the courier. double BKB. Double BKB, actually. Duh. No, it's not about shapeshift. It's about the BKB. I mean, shapeshift is nice, but it's all about the double BKB. Double satanic as well. Double bash. Abyssal. I'm looking at the abilities when I should be looking at the items that Refresher will give him. Another Boots of Travel pick up a Chibi. Just been caught by DDZ. Can he get the Sonic Boom in time? No, no Deafening Blast is going to come out. And Chibi walks himself away. It's very, very low, but fortunately, he's going to be able to dodge Sunstrike. So he's going to get his Refresher now. They need to give him his own courier to use that Refresher. Man, 36 to 70, 76 minutes in, a 30,000 experience lead, a 30,000 gold lead. It just keeps on building for Scythe. But they clearly have an advantage here. But if they make one big misplay, I mean, there is still the rat advantage here for Arrow Gaming. The Invoker is so tough to deal with when he's maxed out level like this, and he's moving around the map with that Ghost Walk. He can very easily pick off some certain squishy heroes like Chibi here, who is taking a small amount of damage from the Ford Spirits, not thinking it means anything. But if he gets him low enough, that DDZ is able to pop him real quickly. Keep expecting him to go for it. Meanwhile, we have a four-man standoff in the top lane. Both heroes just looking at each other, but Arrow is not expected to force a fight while DDZ has the opportunity to go for a pickoff like this. But can he actually do it? Because if he doesn't successfully burst down this Marana, Marana's going to be able to pop the Satanic, turn, and probably out-heal the rest of the damage from DDZ. Shows himself once again. Chibi immediately pops the Manta. Leaps away. DDZ can catch up rather easily, but Moonlight Shadow is going to be used. Good enough for the Invoker. DDZ backs himself up to the base. I don't think they can force a 5 versus 4 in time here, though. Refresher is picked up. There it is. Miracle just needs his own courier to be able to utilize it. Black Hole going to be used, and it's going to be able to catch up too. Come. He's going to be able to stop that Black Hole immediately. Miracle wandering around with a Piggy. He needs to be able to pop in Satanic. Another Scythe device used. They're trying to hold him down. They're trying to burst him out, but he's not going to get it. Satanic pop. Miracle. Ghost Scepter by Shang Tsung. The timing, they do finish him off. There goes the Lycan instantly buying back. Lance trying to get away from the massive amount of magic damage. Chibi goes for the kill. He's not going to be able to get it. The last hit is not quite enough, and now Chibi has just leapt into the danger zone. He pops in Satanic. He's going to be able to keep himself alive. Lycan has already teleported himself in. Finished off that tier 3. Arrow. Going to need to start utilizing some buybacks here in order to defend their last set of racks here. Rags goes down. Rage Rags going to fall. Miracle's committing to this one. Meanwhile, Chibi's going for the kill onto the supports. He's going to be able to go for MTR. Doesn't quite get him. Miracle, they've got Mega Creeps, but can they actually win the fight? Lance, he's been abyssaled up. Turns around. Goes on Pelosin. DDZ comes forward. They need some pickups here. They're going to be able to find the center at the very least. Chibi in the back. He's still going for MTR. When are they going to put a stop to this? Marana, a second hero goes down. Now Shang Tsung starts focusing him. They will be able to take out the Marana eventually here. The Satanic, though, keeps on healing him up. Now the Tornado comes in. Finally, Chibi will fall eventually. The Shivas catches him out. Bounce around from the Lich. Lance getting low, but not enough to be able to finish him off. That's for sure, at least not yet. Lance, Pelosin goes in from double edge, but Death Prophet denies herself real quickly. And Scythe successfully get the Mega Creeps. Arrow Gaming, they got to go for a five-man push now. They got to try and end this game. Marana has a buyback. They're going to find out Pelosin. This is good. BKB pops. But he's got the room for a dagger. 1 second left. Blink away, and he gets it. Pelosin, who did not have a buyback, may just successfully get himself away. No, he gets caught by the hookshot. Zhang Zai will hold him in long enough for the rest of his team to come in, and that means there is going to be at least one hero down in the five-man death push coming up for Arrow. But they still have their Enigma on cooldown as well. 35 seconds. Unlikely Arrow will be able to four-man into the enemy base in time because Marana down for 50 seconds, but they have a buyback for. So all they could do at this point in time is force a 4 versus 4, and that's just not going to happen. Mega Creeps, for Scythe. Few times have teams come back from Mega Creeps. And there is no obvious advantage here for Arrow. That's going to be allow them to go straight for the base. Now, they certainly do have the firepower to be able to defend their base for a while, but eventually they're going to get chipped down. One misplay again, though. I can't stress this enough. There is no tier fours left. 4,250 health on the Ancient. That is nothing this late into the game. If Arrow can make some sort of clutch play and go straight for the back door, they can do this. But it's not going to be your traditional win. It is not going to be on the back of just running into the base. I think they have to make, and this is going to sound greedy as hell, I think they have to make a Necronomicon play. I think they have to go for a mass teleport into Necronomicons. At the same time, they still need a creep wave to be inside of the base in order to stop that backdoor protection. And I don't see it. I don't see how they're going to be able to push these lanes enough. I mean, Lance, look at him in the middle lane. He is being stalled out considerably by these main creeps. Death Prophet is not the greatest pusher when creeps have 1,000 health. Still, though, if he gets, I suppose if you get enough super creeps, the difference is not that much. DDZ is actually going to be going for Lich, trying to take him out real quickly, unable to do so, and now DDZ, focus down, no buyback. That's it right there. Lycan just finished off the Enigma. Death Prophet teleports back to base, but that's 2 minutes on the DDZ. That's 1 minute on the Enigma.
Radiant's middle Scythe tower is under attack.
100%. I mean, they needed some serious desperation plays on Arrow in order to come back
Radiant's
into this
middle
game.
Tower
81
is under
minutes.
Attack.
And it was going to be off the back of something to do with DDZ. With him down for a minute and a half still, there's no way. Clockwork is going to miss his hook. X Freedom able to blow up the Shadow Demon real quickly and get himself out in time
Radiant's
with the Moonlight Shadow. And now here comes the push. Lycan already taken one of those tier fours. Lance pops the Exorcism, but what can you do? Arrow lands on him. He's able to get himself away though. Pops the Abyssal Blade where he can. Ghost Scepter trying to help him out as much as possible, but Lance just being right clicked down. Miracle's going to be going deep here into the enemy base, knowing that this game is all theirs, and Scythe will take game two in the quarterfinals of the Join Dota League, moving on to the semifinals successfully. Well played by Scythe. An unbelievably close match. 1 hour and 21 minutes. One of the longer games I've ever had to cast. That was damn good. Well played by both sides. Arrow put on one hell of a show in the early game, got themselves that early advantage with the mid racks and the tier three at the bottom lane, and eventually took the bottom racks as well. Unfortunately, just took them too long, and Scythe were able to take over the game, particularly on the back of Miracle's Lycan. So well done by Scythe. They win the series 2-0 and will be moving on to the semifinals to face up against Titan. And the winner of that matchup will then go on to the finals to face up against Invasion Esports. Thanks so much for tuning in, guys. We are going to be taking a break now. That's right, just a break. We have no more Dota to be casting for the day, but we will probably do, I'm not sure if we'll do sub-in-houses or maybe just regular first-person games, some pubs. I'm not sure which, but I need to give my voice a little bit of a rest. So give it about 15 minutes. We'll be back, though. For those of you guys who were just here for the Dota, thanks so much for tuning in. YouTube.com/joinDOTA. More content is going to be going up on there. We have lots of tournaments that we're going to be casting starting next week. So be sure to subscribe over there for the VODs, as well as go to joindota.com for all your updates, such as the Dota 2 Champions League Season 4 that was just announced today. Check that out, joindota.com, and everything else. Follow me at Dota Capitalist. See you guys later.